Hello, everyone. So today I'm going to tell about a project that is going on in Mozilla called WebThings. I'm a tech speaker at Mozilla where I talk about the emerging technologies, and today we are going to see the privacy and security concerns related to Internet of Things. With the advent of Internet of Things, we are making our life simpler, but is it so? We have our smart devices and we have our dumb devices. Our thermostat, let's say if our thermostat is sharing our data, but it better not share this data with someone else, and that would be strange, right? We don't want definitely that. Last year, in 2017, I gave a talk at GeekCamp about the dark side of Internet of Things, where I talked about the issues and the exploits that can be done when you upload your lives to the internet. Has anyone attended the 2017 from the audience, if you remember this talk? Okay, so the highlights of this talk were how you can basically exploit using physical network, physical, local, and remote access to the Internet of Things. And if you are interested in watching this talk, it's on the GeekCamp channel. I discussed about this Shodan search engine. I'll just give a quick highlights of what we discussed, and this talk could be the continuation of what we had discussed. The Shodan search engine. From the audience, anyone has used this engine before? Okay, I see a few hands. So this engine says it's the search engine for Internet of Things. So basically, let's see what are the search results. And you probably don't want these search results to be displayed at a conference at GeekCamp. I'm just showing, and you don't want your lives to be uploaded and displayed at a conference. But it's doing that, and it's legal. People don't know about it. Moving on to the challenges and limit smart home automation adoption are that the first challenge is that we have a vertical silo. That means we have brand-specific API. They spend a lot on APIs and then service and mobile apps for an IoT device. And in the end, what we get is a high device cost. Buying a smart home currently means that we buy different incompatible items. You buy a light bulb, then you have to buy a hub. But your bulb won't communicate with your garage because of the technology limitations, the protocols, and the company is different. So it's limiting us. It's not giving us the smart home adoption scenario. And if a brand fails, or if you fail to pay the subscription fee, and then you end up having a device which is incompetent and you can't do anything with it. Most importantly, you don't know where your data is going. It goes to a cloud and then it comes back to you, but in between that, what if someone is monitoring your data? You have no control over it, but we are doing it for the sake of simplicity, and we're not thinking about this side much, but it should be thought much in this, what we have to do. And some devices stops working when there is no internet connection. Mozilla did a research where they found out that most people fear that the things that concern them is like the monthly services for IoT devices are too high. It compromises your personal security, and the initial cost of setup would be too much. So here, WebThings, Mozilla's project WebThings comes to the rescue. Where we have developed a system which puts people first. The mission is to put more stress on privacy, security, and interoperability. And we are participating in W3C, Web of Things Interest Group, to promote standard-based things description that use common schemas, which I'm going to talk about later. Now, Web of Things by Mozilla. So the aim is to directly control your things without any middlemen, without any cloud services, or without paying anything for anything. You just buy a device, probably a Raspberry Pi, and we also got one in the quiz session. You can just start using that. And your data stays at your home by default. You can choose if you want to upload it on internet, but it stays with you. And you can expand a number of devices. You can basically use ZigBee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, ESP, and a lot of devices, and just connect them to each other. So how it works? You have your normal, typical vendor, which saves your data in the cloud, and your data is then accessed by the applications. But with Smart Home, we have a HTTPS tunneling service. So there is a cloud involved. There is a web involved, but there is no cloud involved in it. So it's not being stored, but it's being tunneled to your home system. So it's stored locally, but you have a choice. You can use authentications and third-party applications for the data you want to be uploaded to the cloud. So you have a control over your own data. The Things Gateway version currently is 0.9.2, and it works on a Raspberry Pi or a web router that Microsoft, this Mozilla is working, called Taurus Omnia. So what goes in the cloud is your remote access tunnels, just your accesses or some updates that are not compromising your data. And the future options could be using third-party web apps and services, using OAuth authentications and other things. So the Web of Things smart toaster, let's take an example of a smart thing, how it works in Mozilla IoT. We are giving URL links to everything. So it's very web-friendly. Here we have defined a smart toaster. Believe me, there are smart toasters available now. So I'm just taking an example of that. We have a toaster whose properties have been defined as the type is Boolean. That's what the machine readable data. And then we can write a description that's human readable. And we can also give some links to external the hyperlinks. Here I have given to one of the properties. We can set another property of time remaining, or then it shows like how much time is being left by clicking this link. And actions, the device performs some actions that can be described. And then the events. So if your toast is ready, then it gives an event that your toast is now ready. And all, everything is now connected to a link, so you can access these properties and do control the devices using these links. So the Web of Things is an application layer on the top of existing IoT protocols and standards. It's not about competing with the data, with the technologies, but it's about complying with them. It's important to understand that the idea of Web of Things is not to compete with the existing protocols like ZigBee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth, but rather to provide a unified application layer which runs on top of all of them. So a common integration of Web of Things would be, we have a thing that directly talks to the cloud, or we have things that are resource constrained that don't have an internet connectivity. That need a gateway to bridge between the cloud or the internet and the device. Or third, we have different devices at different place of worlds, and we just connect them with them using direct cloud. So the first example would be for a direct integration would be a Wi-Fi camera. Another one could be door sensors and light sensors and switches. And the third one would be maybe like air pollution sensors all around the world giving data on a cloud. So the Web of Things framework is something like, we have a cloud, we have Things Gateway, and then we have the things. So the things are the devices that are inside your home. The gateway is what it connects it to the cloud, and the cloud is the good old cloud where you can tunnel the data and control the devices. And a future option would be to have a controller that can turn on or turn off or some give some voice commands or some AR headsets, something like those. The architecture of this gateway we have at the back end a Node.js server, web server is running. We have progressive web apps, a front end HTML and CSS and JavaScript running UI, which I'm going to show you later on. We have different adapters running their own process. You can use Arduino, Rust, Node.js, and different things. And if some device or adapter crashes, then it won't compromise the whole system because they're running in parallel. And then we have the cloud where we have a TLS tunneling service to get an access of them. So you can control over the internet. Talking about the security, so we are using HTTPS via Mozilla IoT.org tunneling services, which uses end-to-end encryption, so you can't sniff between the HTTPS and get the data. We have subdomains that are using Let's Encrypt TLS certificate, and you can also configure your own DNS or TLS. So you have the control over your devices, and you can also use some firewalls or domains or whatever you want. We are using JSON web tokens for authentication, and for third-party applications, we are using OAuth. Implementing Web of Things. So how can we do it? We can start implementing them in Java, C++, Python, Node.js, Rust, and it's completely open source, and a big community is contributing to it. And you can be a part of it. You can just pick up a language you're comfortable in, develop a adapter or a gateway or something else. And We have a lot of options. You have it's very secure framework where even for third party services you can enable or disable SSH, create OAuth tokens, give authorizations, and view the logs and everything else. So how can I start it? How can I start building my own thing? Get your first step would be to get a Raspberry Pi. And then use the gateway on the website that I'm going to share later on, and then plug the device in it and burn the image. The link is here, iot.mozilla.org/gateway. You put it in your Raspberry Pi, and this screen comes up, a welcome screen, where you can choose a subdomain and email. So this is how the GUI looks. And then you can add a device. It can be any device. It can be some Zigbee, Node MCU, or whatever you can think of that can connect with the Pi. It can be connected via USB or serially talking with the Pi or something else. And then you have add-ons, a number of add-ons that are constantly built by the communities. For few bulbs, for routers, even you can create virtual things and test your ideas and prototypes. And it all runs on the web, so it's very web friendly. The UI looks something like this. So in a browser, it opens like you have different connections, like light bulbs on and off. And then it's very user friendly. You can use the GUI to create rules, set of rules, so you don't need to know coding, or if you are not into much hardware, you can just simply drag and drop and define the rules. You can also use floor plans. So you can upload a SVG of your floor plan, a home floor plan, and just do the connections and control your home with this. It's something can be much more feasible to you. And the rules, I'm going to show this in a demo later on, how you can just define, how easy it is to define rules in set of instructions. An example would be using a lamp. So we can adjust the brightness, turn it on and off. This is how the GUI looks. So that's pretty much it. And then let's see how it looks in. So I have a Raspberry Pi that's just getting power from my laptop, and it's already has a this setup of gateway. So this you can set the domains. I'll just refresh to make sure it's working. Okay, let's try to adjust the. So these are different devices. This is how the GUI looks all in all, and it's being run from Raspberry Pi. Now we have this different things. We have a We have things that are connected. We have rules that we can define. Then we have also logs if you want to log something. We can upload a floor plan and just drag and drop the devices and just edit the button here and just position to our floor plan just for the sake of convenience. In the settings, we have a domain which we can use to remote access or local access. The network is, you can just set up the network. You can connect the Pi to Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. The users, you can give privileges to who you want to access the devices. Yeah, so this is the important part where add-ons, like you can see a lot of people have been developing a lot of add-ons. If you want to add some add-ons, you can just press this add button and you can add counters and some adapters for earthquake monitoring and some sensor, GitHub. I'll just quickly go through the list. Microblocks is a very good one that I've been using. It has its own Wi-Fi, if you are familiar with it. You can send tweets with your smart home that the light is turned on, turned off, but your data still remains secure. You're just giving notifications out. The ones that I have installed are these, and just you can just configure them. So once you add them, to add them, you just press the add button. I'll just add this one, and it starts installing. And then you can just configure them like whatever you want to do. This one pulse creates some pulses of ones and zeros. You can just set them like this. And then we have, if there are any updates, it shows the updates for your add-ons. The authorizations is you can, let's do the authorization and okay. So for the developer, the ones I showed in the presentation, you can enable disable SSH, create local authentications. So you can just choose what you want the authentication to be. And you just allow, and what it does, it creates a token for you, and then you can just start easily using. And there are a lot of support in it. We have JS and curl and Rust. So what else do we have here? You can also add things. So some of the ones that are being used now currently for development purposes are microbits, if you have heard about, and this Playground Express. I'll just start passing on if you want to have a look, maybe. So with it's easy to program. It's being programmed using this software called Microblocks. It's just very user-friendly, and it's good for kids who just want to start getting the hold of smart things. You can just, we have, okay, something's not working. Anyways, so you can just define the like set of rules, like connect to something and do something. And then when you upload it, it gives a IP address, and then you can just simply add the IP address and your thing would be connected to the internet, like, and then you can just like give some, oh yeah, okay, I forgot about this thing. So we also have a voice recognition thing. I can just say, let's see if it works. Turn LED on. Turn LED on. Okay, it works. And you can also just see what is being understood by the machine. And you can change this. If you don't want to use this voice recognition, you can just use something else, some add-on. And here it's giving a command to turn all the LEDs on, and then when you do that in this device, the Express Playground that is being passed on, it turns all the lights on it, and it has a Wi-Fi on it, so you can just simply do that. What else? I see we have some time. I prepared some backup slides just in case. So yeah. So let's move on to the Web of Thing descriptions, how you can describe it. Let's take an example of a lamp. We have a lamp which is connected to internet. The properties are Boolean. It's either one or zero. The maximum and the minimum numbers for the property can be zero or one. You can define that, and then you can also connect it to some URL. The action is to toggle. So here it's getting input as a number with the property 0 to 100, and then you can just simply input something, and it adjusts the brightness. Then you have an event. If like it's overheated, it will give you that it has overheated, and all these things are then linked with each other. And you have a very interactive GUI. Let's see this, which one is it? So we have virtual light on and off. This is a rule I created, very quick and simple. So this rule is basically, let's create a new rule. So we have a rule, maybe I want to use a LED. And then I want to turn an on and off a virtual light. And then what else? And this one. So we can select property, what it does when it's on. And then let's say we want to use a color. So it sets a color. And then we can also set a brightness or just simply turn it on. So this is how a rule is defined. But now we have defined a rule for turning it on, and you can just name the rules. So it's as simple as this. Now we can just check for the LED button, which is already on. Okay, it does nothing because it was already on. But that's how like you can just simply define on rules and off rules pretty easily. And since we have a bit of time, I can show you the showdown search engine I showed in the previous conference, where you can easily access anything over internet. So this is the search engine for webcams or some smart things, and my favorite one is YourCam, which is very common. So this is the search engine, and I don't know, that's like how secure your IoT devices are. If I want to just see what's happening live, I can just simply search for something, some company or something else, and it will show. You can refine it by countries, and you can see a very intuitive map of the world, of the things that are connected to internet, where they are. So that's how secure it is, and it's really an issue that we should think about. So you can see a lot of things. So yeah, that's it, I guess. If you have any questions, or if you want to be in touch, you can tweet me or DM me on Twitter. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Questions? Okay, so I won't be able to answer much technical questions, yeah. But okay. So let's start with, how are about the cloud of popular brands? It's your own cloud, it's your own, if you want to use like some other third party or some other brand's cloud, that you can also do. There are a lot of add-ons, and you can build your own thing and just start using if you are interested in that. Which coding languages are easier to build gateways? Lot of languages are there. It depends on what are convenient for you, but there is a good support at the moment for Rust is still in progress, but others are there. Like C++ is pretty good, Java is pretty good. Does the gateway depends on Mozilla service to function? It does not. If it's not connected to internet or it's not getting any service, it's completely independent and very independent of any third party or something. So it's you who has the control. You can see how it's connecting, how it's talking to things, and what is going on in it. Is gateway suitable for commercial IoTs? So it's still in experimentation, but I mean, you can develop anything. You can use it for commercial applications, but I think it's still something that is for an experimentation phase that Mozilla is doing. I mean, why not? You can try it. We have been using it at smart homes a lot at our homes, and it's working pretty fine, and it's much secure and easy GUI and easy to program. Even kids can program it. So, I mean, that could be used, but it depends on you, actually. Is using MitHub the easiest way to create codes? So you can, the easiest way to create code would be just using drag and drop. Which codes are we talking about here? Okay, I'll probably skip this then. Does it work on IFTTT? Does it works on IFTTT? So it's as I told, it's a application layer on the top of all the existing protocols. So it's like that. It works like that. And does it integrate with platforms like Alexa, Google Home? Yes, it does, and there are a lot of add-ons. And you can also, if you want something that's not here, so you can simply just contributing to iot.mozilla. You can just go here, and then you can just simply check how to build and how to get involved. There is the community blogs and how to install a gateway. So it's pretty easy. There is a guide to getting started. Does the Things gateway run as a Docker image? What's Docker image? What does it mean by that? But I think it's you just flash the image and that's how it basically works, and you can see what's going on inside because it's pretty much open source. You can just go to the GitHub. You can ask me some questions if you have how to do it, and there are a lot of people like Kathy Geary is also using, and I can show you something, some advanced version of what's being going on and what you can do with the control over web since we have a bit of time. If someone has heard about A-frame, some VR, so you can connect Internet of Things to VR. Here we are using the web VR, and we have a color sensor. It was done by one of my colleague, Philip. It detects the color, and then it models them using the color. So like it depends on your imagination, what are the things that you can do. This web VR is something for maybe, like, you can check out. It's one of the project of Mozilla, which is using VR on the web, runs VR on the web. And then it's using the same, like, you can control the devices and change the color, and yeah. So yeah, that's pretty much it. And if you have any further questions or something else, you can always connect to me on Twitter at this link. And thank you.